Assalamu alaikum and good evening. Viewers, Iran is an important neighbor of Pakistan because of its geostrategic location and bonds of common faith, history, culture and other deep-rooted links between the two countries. Today's 21st century's pressing need is to have a grand alliance with your neighboring countries to stand up in difficult times with face-to-face with superpowers of the world. And one of the most important neighboring candidate for such grand alliances for Pakistan is Iran. Pak-Iran close relations are a source of strength not only for both the countries but also for the region. But unfortunately, both countries caught in the serious differences due to the Taliban factor in Afghanistan. Pak-Iran relations since 9/11 have considerably improved from earlier frostiness in the 1990s. Hence, Pakistan is increasingly concerned that any harm or destabilization of Iran through any external military action may create problems not only for Iran but also for Pakistan. In this light, we Pakistanis are very lucky that our historic connection with Iran is alive and nobody succeeded to break this connection. But some questions still arise here. What is the real difference between Iran and Pakistan? Why Iran and Pakistan are finding themselves in an increasingly dark place on the world stage with Pak-Iran gas pipeline? Will this Pak-Iran gas pipeline get materialized? Why is the West helping Pakistan and antagonizing Iran? Today we will analyze all the aspects of Pak-Iran relations as to which direction we should be going in our relations with Iran. As you know, viewers, that I have Mr. Zaid Hamid joining me in my show. Assalamu alaikum, Mr. Zaid Hamid. As you can tell that we will be talking about one of our very important neighbor, which is Iran. Since we would like to show our viewers that how the Pak-Iran relations have been working together, we have put up a report together. Let's have a look at that and then we will come back to our discussions.
Relations between Iran and Pakistan have spanned since the common prehistoric Indo-Iranian heritage. After the establishment of Pakistan on August 1947, Iran has a unique distinction of being the first country to internationally recognize the status of Pakistan. Both countries are economic partners and large-scale tourism and migration between the two nations has increased rapidly. This cooperation would continue throughout the Cold War, with Iran supporting Pakistan in its conflict with arch-rival India. In return, Pakistan went to support Iran militarily during the Iran-Iraq War in 1980s. Recent difficulties have included repeated trade disputes, sphere of influence and political position. Since 2000, the relation between each state has been normalized and economical and militarily collaboration has strengthened the relation ever since. At present, both countries are cooperating and forming alliance against a number of areas of mutual interest on fighting drug trade along their common border, as well as defeating Afghan support tribal insurgency along their border. Iran has been a respected, popular and favorable nation among Pakistanis, with 76% of Pakistanis have consistently viewed their Western neighbor positively, making Pakistan the most pro-Iran nation in the world. Iran has the world's second largest gas reserve after Russia. Iran is helping Pakistan in energy sector. Almost 1,000 kilometers gas pipeline in Pakistan that could reduce energy crisis in the country.
Yes, Mr. Zaid Hamid, as you know that today is the day and age where none of the country can stand alone and it must have a grand alliance with its neighboring countries, and our best neighbor we see in this scenario is Iran. So what do you have to say? How have we been with each other?
See, let me put some facts straight in front of you here. The Arab Muslim world, the Middle East, the Arab countries within the Muslim world are now almost decimated. The large Muslim countries which were surrounding Israel are now under attack, being dismembered. They are being balkanized and their population terrorized and traumatized. Iraq was one of the countries, large Muslim countries, then Syria, Egypt, Libya. The entire Arab Muslim world is under attack. And as the Turkish President Abdullah Gul has said, that the Muslim world is being pushed towards the Stone Age. And this is precisely what you see in the heartland of Muslim civilization, the Arab world. But on the outskirts of it, on the borders of the Arab world, there are three large Muslim countries which are still standing on their feet. One of them is Turkey, other is Iran, and third is Pakistan, which happened to be the only Muslim nuclear armed weapon state. And all these three countries form a regional bloc which stretches from the borders of China to the shores of Europe. The axis between Islamabad, Tehran and Istanbul is so formidable, is so powerful. Almost 400 million Muslims live in this bloc. All share the same faith of Islam. All share the same heritage of culture, history, language, traditions, values, and now common threats. The fact of the matter is, again, that all these three countries are non-Arabic speaking. All these three countries have their own distinct language, Turkish, Persian, and Urdu. And now,
what does that have to do with them? What does Arab language has to do with not being implemented in these countries?
You see, traditionally, historically, these countries were not part of the Arab heartland. So this is something that has been continuing for thousands of years. In the Arabic, traditional classic Arabic language, these were called the Ajami lands, the lands of Ajam, not the Arabs. I mean, this is the, it is something, it's deep-rooted narrative in history that all these territories beyond Iraq were called, which were under the Persian Empire, and all these lands which are in Turkey now were under the Roman Empire, and all these lands which form part of Pakistan now were part of the Hindu India. So traditionally, when the Islam spread in the Middle East, these lands were under Persian, Roman and the Hindu empires, and they were conquered by the Muslim armies moving out of Arabia, invading out of Arabia at that time, and creating three civilizations which today, as we said, are in front of us in the form of three large non-Arabic speaking neighboring Muslim countries stretching from China to Europe. Now the point is that now we have seen that the Muslim world is facing collectively an unprecedented invasion from the Zionist of the West, from neocon evangelical Christian Zionist and the state of Israel. It's an unprecedented invasion. The Muslim civilization is facing an existential threat as a civilization itself. Our culture, our history, our faith, our ideology, our people, our honor is at stake now. And the time has come that unless and until these three Muslim countries stand united, they will fall divided. And that is why it has become precisely extremely important for the world to understand and for these Muslim countries to understand.
But do you think, are these three countries standing united? Do you think that?
You see, this is not happening. This is the tragedy, that still the threat perception, still the threat analysis being done in those capitals, Islamabad, Tehran and Turkey, is such that none of the countries is feeling the heat, that the threat that is coming towards them. They all feel that they may be able to manage it somehow alone, which is a fallacy, which will not happen. Either, as I said, either these nations stand united or fall divided. There is no other option for them. So that's where the relationship between Pakistan and Iran particularly gets very critical, to understand that, because Iran was always projected, one of the targets of the Western world for the Americans and the Israelis, always included in the so-called axis of evil, where Iran is supposed to, that's how it's being projected. And we know that in the years to come, or in the months to come, Iran would be invaded, Iran would be subjected to the fourth generation war, which Pakistan is being subjected already. Pakistan is already facing an existential threat.
Mr. Zaid Hamid, so now when all these three countries, Iran, Pakistan and Turkey, they know the threats that they're facing, then what is the problem? Are they standing united or they're being divided?
See, this is the tragedy. All three countries are still standing alone. They're not cooperating in a collective security arrangement. What is happening is that each country is thinking and developing response strategies on their own, on its own, on itself, without developing a collective response to the threats which we have seen annihilated the greater Middle East, the Muslim lands in the Arab countries. So the time has come that Pakistan and Iran particularly, because the relationship between Pakistan and Iran is such that it affects the dynamics in Afghanistan, it neutralizes the threat that Pakistan faces from India, and it also neutralizes the threat that Pakistan faces in Balochistan. Because just like Kurdistan in northern Iraq, where the Americans have almost created an independent Kurd state, the Israelis, the Americans, the new cons want to create an independent Balochistan, and that means a large chunk of land from Iran and Pakistan would be taken away and created into a new land of Balochistan, just like Kurdistan. And this threat is so real that the American congressmen, the policymakers, the defense strategists have already been planning, have already been discussing this openly at all levels, from United Nations to the US Congress. They are talking about an intervention in Balochistan under the pretext of so-called human rights violations by Pakistan government against the Balochi people. And let me tell you one thing also, that few years ago, an American amphibious division had already made a landing, amphibious landing on the coast of Balochistan under the context of fighting a war against drugs. And they have prepared a landing, they have done it, they have practiced, they silently moved into Balochistan.
Mr. Zaid Hamid, you just mentioned that all these three countries are standing alone. But don't we see Pakistan and Iran relations going back all the way till the times of Shah? They have been brothers, they have been very closely related to each other. So what about all that?
You see, the Pakistan and Iran relations can be divided into two phases. First phase is since 1947 till 1979, when Shah was present in Iran. And those times and those periods were one of the most cordial relationships between Pakistan and Iran. Pakistan was under the American camp at that time. Shah was also under the American camp. And there was absolutely no hostility between Tehran and Islamabad. In fact, when there was an Pakistan army conducted counter-insurgency operations in Balochistan in the 70s, the Iranian armed forces actually came to help Pakistan army. Iranian helicopters and pilots were assisting the Pakistan army in fighting the Baloch insurgents, who were backed by the Soviet Marxist, Leninist and the Indians. So the relationship between Pakistan and Iran historically, and as you saw in 1947, Iran was the first country to recognize Pakistan when Pakistan was created.
Right.
So those relationships were brilliant. In 1965 war, when Pakistan was fighting against the Indians, the entire Iranian support was at the back of Pakistan. So that was the one phase of our relationship. But in 1979, three major events took place in this entire region. The Iranian Revolution came, which overthrew Shah. Pro-American Shah and anti-American government of Ayatollah Khomeini came into power. Soviets invaded Afghanistan, and an armed resistance began. Afghan jihad began in Afghanistan also. And thirdly, Iraq invaded Iran into what we call is the first Gulf War, in which the Arabs attacked the Iranians, or in a different perspective, it became a war between the Sunnis and Shias.
So let me ask you this here. You said in 1979 the Islamic Iranian Revolution took place successfully. Does that Islamic Revolution have anything to do with the Russian troops arrival in Afghanistan and then Iraq invading Iran?
You see, as far as the...
Are these three interconnected with each other?
The Soviet invasion of Afghanistan was an independent event. Soviet invasion of Afghanistan was something that Soviets had been planning for decades to do this, even before the First World War. Even the British feared that the Soviets would invade Afghanistan. And that was a process built into history, which was in any case had to come. In 79, the Soviets decided the time had become ripe. The internal dynamics of Afghanistan were such that the Communist Party in Afghanistan, the PDPA, their factions were fighting amongst each other. The Muslim rebellion and resistance was growing up. So Soviets finally decided to move into Afghanistan in December 79. And almost at the same time, the Iranian Revolution took place in Iran. But the more critical element, the more critical aspect which divided the entire Muslim world at that time, was not the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan nor the Iranian Revolution. It was the Iraq's invasion or attack on Iran, the Iran-Iraq war, where all the Arabs were on the side of the Iraqis and Iran was standing alone on one side trying
to... So that was a time when there was a division between Muslim world as Shiite and Sunnis.
Arabs and non-Arabs as well as Shias and Sunnis. And the friction, the divide between the Muslim world for the first time, the fissures were created around 1979 when these three major tectonic events took place.
Happened. We will continue our discussion right from here. Viewers, stay with us. We'll be right back after a short break. Welcome back, viewers. We're talking on Pakistan and Iran relations. These relations go long way back. We do share a prehistoric culture, religious and language sharing there. But what's the pressing need of today's time and age? Do we need a grand alliance to stand together to fight back against the superpowers of the world? Or can we survive at our own, standing individually? But what's the best strategy to proceed with our relations with Iran? Mr. Zaid Hamid, before going on the break, we reached till 1979 when three major events happened: the Islamic Revolution in Iran, second, the Russian troops invasion in Afghanistan, and third, the Iraq invasion in Iran. But what happened in Pakistan in 1979? Did General Zia also contributed in this division of the Muslim world of Shiite and Sunnis?
I would very strongly reject this allegation. Normally, the Shia community in Pakistan accused General Zia of sponsoring sectarian terrorism in Pakistan. Nothing can be further from truth. This is a fallacy. This is an absolute false allegation on President Zia. President Zia at that time was ruler of Pakistan, and he was fighting a very difficult war in Afghanistan against the Soviet invasion. And Pakistan was at that time had very strong influence of the Americans, Saudis and Kuwaitis in Pakistan. And at that time, while simultaneously Iran-Iraq war was also taking place.
Right.
The Shias in Iran were buoyant, energetic. They were very joyous at a revolution taking place in Iran. And at the same time, when Afghan Mujahideen came into Pakistan, Afghan resistance was primarily a Sunni resistance. All the major Afghan groups which are based in Pakistan and fighting the Soviets were dominantly, all of them were Sunnis. And because of Iranian revolution and subsequent Iran-Iraq war, war spilled into Pakistan when Iran started to support the militant groups in Shia militant groups in Pakistan, and Saudis and Kuwaitis started to support Sunni militant groups in Pakistan fighting a proxy war without the permission of Pakistan government. General Zia did not allow it. He was not insane to allow Iranians or Saudis to fight proxy war on the streets of Pakistan when Pakistan was already under attack from KGB, RAW, Mossad, Khad, all the different secret services, because Pakistan was fighting against the Soviets in Afghanistan. So this proxy war, Pakistan had excellent relationship with Iran at that time. Pakistan has excellent relationship with Arabs at that time. And Pakistan was caught in the middle. But so what General Zia did, he tried very hard at the international level, he tried very hard to stop the war between Iran and Iraq. If you hear his speech in Casablanca, which he made in the Organization of Islamic Conference meeting.
Because a very important member of the Muslim country is absent from this august body. Iran was isolated 3 years ago. Iran, in spite of the invitation, did not participate in the third Islamic summit at time. But it should be noted with the great pleasure that Iran participated in the foreign ministers' conference held in Dhaka and did contribute. Whether Iran comes to attend this fourth Islamic summit or not, it should not be important. What is important is what is the gesture of the remaining 43 countries. And it is for this reason I very strongly urge, and I support President Sukhothore's suggestion, that Iran should be invited. The second question which President Sukhothore raised, which has been the subject of heated argument and in which we have dragged everything on earth in our debates, from Islam down to the Palestinian issue. I have only a few very honest and sincere submissions to make in this respect. I wish to reiterate in the beginning that I am representing Pakistan. And Pakistan's track record is as clear as it should be. Pakistan has supported the unity of the Islamic effort all along. Pakistan has had the honor of defending the rights of many Muslim as well as non-Muslim countries in their effort of not only self-determination, but in their effort to acquire freedom. And I do not wish to blow my own trumpet at this stage. I also wish to state that Pakistan is not in support of Egypt's action of accepting Camp David Accord. I also want to put across that Pakistan's track record for the support of Palestinians has been undimmed. And I think Brother Arafat, who's sitting very close to me, I should be the person who should have said something on this subject. But the point which I want to bring home, Your Majesty, is that Egypt today is being debarred as a very deliberate decision which must have been taken by this August body. Egypt has been debarred by the Organization of Islamic Conference from participation until such time the conditions which has been read out by two eminent spokesmen of not letting Egypt enter, the reasons for this. But my point is a different one. My point is that Egypt was first debarred from the Arab League. Egypt was then debarred from entry by the Organization of Islamic Conference. If Egypt today is not being brought to the fold by the Arab League, the decision for this, whether we agree or not, is immaterial. But I suggest, Your Majesty, that this body, the Organization of Islamic Conference, which was created for the unity of the Islamic world, must not be subservient to the decision of the Arab League. Let Arab League decide.
He spoke of sending a delegation to Tehran to bring Tehran into the OIC fold again, because the Arabs had thrown Iran out, and also bringing the Egypt in, because Egypt was also thrown out because it had signed the Camp David Accord. So General Zia's role was of a pacifier within the Muslim world. He was trying to pacify the frictions and the hostilities between Iran and the Arabs. Pakistan had good relations with Saudi Arabia and with Iran, but Iran and Saudi Arabia were fighting with each other, and that had put Pakistan in a very dangerous situation, difficult situation, because they were fighting a proxy war on the streets of Pakistan also, which continue to this day. So this was, but when Iran actually, the moments came to when Iran was actually losing the war against Iraq, because the American and the NATO and all the Arab world were actually behind Saddam Hussein, and Iran was running out of supplies and weapons. And there were moments and there were times when actually Zia supported Iran also, helped Iran to stabilize, otherwise Iran would have been overrun. And this is the secret aspect of history which nobody knew, nobody writes, nobody talks about. But the fact is that General Zia actually tried to help Iran at that time with medicine, supplies, all the humanitarian aid which could be given, which Iran was not getting at that time. So the role of Pakistan at that time was of a pacifier. Pakistan was not taking side in the Iran-Iraq war, but of course Pakistan was taking a very strong side in Afghanistan, where we were trying to throw the Soviets out. So, but the fact is, the relationship between Pakistan and Afghanistan, primarily after the assassination of General Zia, deteriorated very strongly. Why? Because Afghanistan, the Shias in Afghanistan felt alienated by the Sunni militant groups, Sunni Mujahideen groups which are based in Pakistan. Iran felt that Shias did not get a fair deal. When the government was installed after the Soviet withdrawal, the government was announced, Shias had no share into it. Iran was angry at that. And when, especially in the 90s, when the Taliban came to power, there was a general perception in Iran that Pakistan had created Taliban, when in fact Pakistan had not created Taliban.
But then let me ask you this, after the Russian troops withdrawal from Afghanistan, wasn't there a competition between Pakistan and Iran to have more influence in Afghanistan, with Islamabad supporting the Pakhtuns in Afghanistan, and then Iran supporting the North Alliance of Uzbeks, Tajiks, and Hazaras.
Let me put the record straight.
Wasn't Iran and Tehran head-to-head with each other in that time?
Not after the Soviet withdrawal. You see, Soviets withdrew in 1988. And till 1992, Kabul was ruled by Najibullah, the communist. And against Najibullah, all the Mujahideen factions were united and together. There were 6 or 7 Shia parties in Afghanistan. But Shias in Afghanistan were already a minority, and within them there were 6 or 7 parties. And they were based in Iran. But the main fighting that was done in Afghanistan were done by the Sunni parties, which constitute about 95% of the resistance in Afghanistan at that time. So when the Soviets withdrew, all the parties fought against Najibullah's communist regime, and in 92, when the communist regime also fell, it was at that time when the Sunni parties started to fight with each other. When Pashtuns became on one side, Ahmad Shah Massoud became on one side, Hikmatyar was on another, and there was actually a civil war started between on ethnic lines in Afghanistan. It was at that time that the Shias, the Shia parties, sided with the Tajiks and Uzbeks at that time and created a kind of northern alliance. But when, in the mid-90s, when the Taliban rose to power, Taliban destroyed all the 6 parties that Pakistan had created, and Taliban were a wild card. They emerged out of nowhere. And they took on the Northern Alliance. They attacked the Sunni Tajiks, they attacked Sunni Uzbeks, and they attacked Shia Hazaras. So the war of Taliban was not against any sect. They were fighting against Sunnis also. Tajiks were Sunnis, Uzbeks were Sunnis, but Taliban were fighting against them as well. So Iran's argument that the Taliban were created by Pakistan to fight the Shias, it was basically based on misperception, because Taliban were killing the Sunnis also. They were actually fighting against the Tajiks and Uzbeks as well. So it was during this period, when the Taliban were in power, and Taliban were very ruthless against the Shias, no doubt about it. And that is why there was lots of misunderstanding between Pakistan and Iran during the 90s. But the fact is, you see, if you note that, even despite the misunderstandings and ups and downs in the relationship, Pakistan and Iran have never gone to war with each other. Pakistan's border with Iran is the most secure border for Pakistan. There are no Pakistani troops against Iran. There have been Pakistani deployments.
But is it still Islamabad and Tehran at odds with each other, or has it resolved after the arrival of US and NATO in Afghanistan?
You see, Iranian policy is the same for the last 30 years, ever since the revolution has come. The policies and the governments in Pakistan keep on changing. When, for example, as I said, during the Musharraf time, it was a different Pakistan government here fighting a different difficult war in Afghanistan and trying to bring Iran and Iraq war to a close. During Benazir and Nawaz Sharif in the 90s, there was total confusion in Pakistan. There was no Iran-related policy, just like there was no Afghan policy. During the Musharraf tenure, again, Pakistan was totally under the American influence, and Iranians were supporting the Northern Alliance, while Pakistan was supporting the Americans as well, in fact in a kind of way supporting the Northern Alliance as well against the Pashtun Taliban. During the Zardari era, the Saudis were very uncomfortable with Zardari, and Zardari tried to build some relations with Iran at that time. The Iran gas pipeline deal and all these things started off during the Zardari tenure. But again, when Nawaz Sharif has now come, and Nawaz Sharif is supposed to be very close to Saudis, and Saudis again are absolutely at war with Iran. They're not comfortable. So they have again put a chokehold on Islamabad not to build any relationship with Iran. As a result, you see the new Nawaz Sharif government has completely abandoned all the projects, all the economic projects that Pakistan had with Iran. But the issue is much more deeper now. The fact is now it's not just about economic relationships or building a pipeline or what happens in Afghanistan. It's an existential threat which Pakistan and Iran face together now. Because Americans plan to leave Afghanistan, or majority of it, the bulk of their forces. And till that time, they need Pakistan or Iran. Americans have just signed a strategic nuclear deal with Iran for 6 months. And that is the time which Americans are trying to buy off. Americans are trying to appease Iran only for a brief period of time, so that the American bulk hardware can be taken out of Afghanistan, because the Pakistani NATO supplies are still blocked. So Americans have shifted their balance, shifted their weight towards Iran temporarily. But we know that once the American evacuation is done from Afghanistan, both Iran and Pakistan would be the next countries on target list. And this is where Pakistan and Iran need to do much more than just economic cooperation or gas pipelines. A collective security arrangement needs to be developed, where Pakistan can give both the countries, Turkey and Iran, a nuclear umbrella, We are a nuclear armed state. If a joint security arrangement can be arranged, just like the Americans give a nuclear umbrella to NATO, Americans give a nuclear umbrella to Taiwan or to Japan, why can't Pakistan give a nuclear umbrella to Muslim lands all around the Muslim countries? Saudi Arabia, Turkey, Iran, Pakistan can come under Pakistan's nuclear protective umbrella.
So you think Pakistan, being the only Muslim country as a nuclear power, can become the Muslim superpower in the Muslim world by offering this nuclear umbrella?
You see, this is why
in the times of hardship.
You see, the fact of the matter is Pakistan has no choice now. Either Pakistan stand alone and fall as we are being crushed from all sides, or Pakistan make a collective security and defense arrangement with 400 million Muslims of this entire region and offer them a collective security umbrella, which the potential that Pakistan has.
And so basically Pakistan has the potential to be offering as a grand alliance factor to other countries, rather than going and asking for a grand alliance from other countries. We will talk on this right after a short break. We will stay with us. We'll be right back after a short break. Welcome back, viewers. We're talking on Pakistan and Iran relations, and we just figured out that Pakistan, being the only Muslim nuclear power, can offer an umbrella of a support of a nuclear power in the times of threats to other Muslim countries. Instead of going for a grand alliance, it can offer a grand alliance from its end, being a nuclear power, to other Muslim countries. Mr. Zaid Hamid, if Pakistan proceeds with the clear mind of offering this nuclear umbrella to other Muslim countries, and the countries that it has in line with itself is Iran, Afghanistan, and Turkey, even if these four can stand together, they can become a serious threat to the outside world.
See, we don't need to be a threat to the outside world. The fact is that
But when we do get threats from the outside world, then why can't we be a threat
to the entire region, this huge landmass of Muslims, just on the borders of the Arab heartland of Muslim civilization, we are under attack. We have seen what they have done to the Muslim heartland. They are being dismembered, butchered, decimated. And now it's our turn. It's coming to us. Pakistan, Iran, and Turkey and Afghanistan is already finished and decimated. But this is, we can handle Afghanistan if Pakistan, Iran, Turkey get together. All the groups which are in Afghanistan, either they are Uzbeks, Tajiks, or Pashtuns,
how do you see the
they
connectivity?
Are controlled by these three countries.
How do you see the connectivity of Pakistan, Iran, and Afghanistan? This triangular connectivity, how do you see this?
You see, we need to add Turkey into this block as well. Because the fact is, Rashid Dostum is an Uzbek and he lives in Turkey. The Tajiks are very close to Iran, and Tajiks are close to Turkey also. And the Pashtuns are close to Turkey, and Pashtuns are close to Pakistan. So even if the Afghans don't have the capacity to sit together, they can be brought to sit together by Tehran, Islamabad, and Ankara. And this is what needs to be done, because the fact of the matter remains, these are the last Muslim countries still left standing. In our turn is next in line. And there are two major powers in this region. One is Israel, which is expanding in the Middle East, and another is India, which is expanding in Asia. India has been given a role by the Zionist powers of the West as to act as a regional policeman, to act as a regional custodian, to act as a regional representative
but
of the Western powers in Asia.
But isn't Iran and India are promoting really good relations these days, and then India is promoting with Afghanistan as well? How do you see the Indian penetration in all these Muslim countries?
You see, what we need to understand is that it is the Indian strategy to create threats for Pakistan on the western borders. Never in Pakistan's history we had any problem on our western borders, but ever since the Americans have come into Afghanistan, Pakistan now has to deploy almost 150,000 or 200,000 troops towards Afghanistan. But still Pakistan has not deployed any troops on the Iranian side. But the Indians are trying this. And Indians have been trying very hard for a very long time to build relationship with Iran. But during the last few years, Iranians have, during the time of Ahmadinejad also, I had an opportunity of visiting Iran and had a serious discussion with Iranian leadership as well. I met Ahmadinejad as well. And we had seriously long discussions on what India wants in the region. And once the Iranians actually knew of the Indian game plan, we can see from the fact at that time Iranian leadership gave some very strong statements against India, and relationship between Indians and Tehran at that time, just a couple of years back, had gone to a new low level, where Iranians actually had been speaking against the Indian atrocities in Kashmir, and it even talked of Hindu Zionism. So the fact is that Iranians need to be educated, they need to be approached by Pakistan, they need to be respected, they need to be more given more confidence that Pakistan would maintain a strong, solid, steady policy towards Iran. And Iran has all the interests.
So, Mr. Zaid Hamid, you talked about Ahmadinejad. What do you think, that was Ahmadinejad better for Pak-Iran relations, or the new President Rouhani is a much better option for the relation between the two?
See, I had met Ahmadinejad, I had met his advisors and policymakers, and I had found them very receptive. And the fact is that, but I have not met Rouhani. I don't know what they think, what the new leadership thinks. The new team has come, the new technocratic government has come into Iran.
But don't you think that Rouhani is making much smarter moves by getting the nuclear agreement done, that interim nuclear agreement done with the six powers? Within 6 months, they will be getting $6 billion. That will give them a real push.
You should keep one thing in mind, is that in Iran, especially in the matters of foreign policy, the real power lies with the spiritual leader, not with the president. So it's basically the state of Iran is being controlled and driven and governed by the spiritual leader, Khamenei, who was also the spiritual mentor of Ahmadinejad, and he's the spiritual mentor.
So why different
Rouhani
policies now with two different presidents?
They're not
if
different.
The spiritual leader is guiding them.
They're not
different
policies.
With
no,
Ahmadinejad.
They are not different policies. In fact, that's brilliant diplomacy. What Iranians have seen is they've seen an opportunity and they've grabbed it. What Iranians have seen is that Americans and relations with Pakistan are getting turbulent. The American supply from Pakistan is being blocked. And Americans snatched the opportunity, and Iranians snatched the opportunity. And because Iranians needed a breather also, Iranians were under pressure over the nuclear program. And they wanted to legitimize their nuclear program and wanted international guarantees that Iran has a right to peaceful nuclear program. And by exploiting the weakness of the Americans in Afghanistan, Iranians have gained a breather for 6 months. And whether this agreement would continue after 6 months or not remains to be seen. But for the time
isn't
being,
Iranian nuclear project will be halted for 6 months in the uranium enrichment. How will that affect for 6 months?
It will see. 6 months is nothing. 6 months is no period. I mean, 6 months in terms of developing a nuclear weapon. 6 months, even if Iran stalls all its nuclear enrichment or a nuclear development program, it would not affect their program. Especially if they legitimize it internationally through agreements. And also they get $6 billion to stabilize their economy. And also they get a leverage over the Americans and so many other places where, in fact, which the term that you don't know yet, but Iran would be squeezing the Americans to get leverage in the Middle East as well, especially over Syria.
So basically Iran is in a win-win situation with this 6 month interim agreement.
One thing that we must give to the Iranians is they're brilliant diplomats. I mean, they really watch over their interests, and whenever they see an opportunity, they grab for it. So this is what we are saying. If there's a confusion in building Pakistan-Iran relationship, the confusion is in Islamabad, not in Tehran. And if there was any misunderstanding in Tehran regarding what Pakistan's policy is towards sectarian killings in Pakistan or in Afghanistan, those misperceptions and confusions can be addressed, can be talked about. They're not so serious that Iranians cannot understand. But the point is, which must be understood again, is that Pakistan now has no choice. Pakistan must get in touch with Tehran and Ankara. Islamabad, Tehran and Istanbul access must be strengthened, because that would neutralize the threats in Afghanistan. That would neutralize the threat which Pakistan faces from India. That would neutralize the threats that the Turkey and Iran faces from fourth generation war and from dismemberment and from reorganization and reshaping of the Middle East. Because, as we said, the Muslim world entirely, in its entirety, is facing a threat which is unprecedented. The entire Muslim world is being balkanized, dismembered, decimated. And the turn of Iran, Turkey and Pakistan is now next. Pakistan is already in the war. We are in the advanced stages already. And it's going to come to Turkey and Iran now.
But then, Mr. Zaid Hamid, since we are the nuclear power, we are the only Muslim state that has a nuclear power, then why do we need Grand Alliance? We can stand alone.
See, Soviet Union was a nuclear armed state as well. It was countering NATO and the Americans. But the urban decentralized fourth generation war which was deployed against the Soviet Union collapsed the economy so much that the Soviet armed forces did not fire a shot, but their country was dismembered. Yugoslavia was the fifth largest army in the world, strongest in Europe. The Yugoslavia were dismembered. Europe's Yugoslavian army could not control, could not contain, could not safeguard their country under the imposed fourth generation war. See, this is exactly what you are seeing in Iraq today. This is Iraq has been dismembered into Kurdistan, Kurd Iraq, Sunni Iraq, Shia Iraq. Similarly, Syria is now being dismembered into Kurd Syria, into Al-Qaeda Syria, into the government-controlled Syria. I mean, and same happened with Sudan, dismembered already. Same is going to happen with Egypt soon. Libya is dismembered, is being balkanized. So the threat is now of balkanization. The threat is now of support to ethnic, linguistic, regional, sectarian groups which would instigate the balkanization of Muslim lands. And Turkey is next. Pakistan is already in it. And in the end, it would be Iran. And the only way that
but
these three Muslim
Zaid
countries
when
can
all
survive
those,
is
all
to
those
unite.
All those Muslim countries that you mentioned, Syria, Egypt, Lebanon, when they couldn't stand all those internal threats, how they are demolished from within, then what do you see? What chances do we have
see,
to
this
stand
is precisely
all those
what I'm saying. All the Muslim countries fell alone. Nobody, none of the Muslim countries formed a collective security alliance against a common threat of Israel and Americans. And this is precisely what I'm saying. Learn from their mistakes. Do not stand alone. Form a collective security bloc. Otherwise, we will all fall alone. And the time is right upon us now. The 2014, the new year that is just beginning now, will bring catastrophe, more catastrophe for the Muslim lands, particularly for Turkey, Iran, and Pakistan. Because we are the only three countries standing. Pakistan is under the most ferocious attack from the Indians and from the Zionists in the West. Why? Because we are the nuclear armed state. And they want to take away Pakistan's nuclear potential. If Pakistan's nuclear potential is taken away under the pretext that Pakistan is a failed or a failing state and its nuclear weapons are about to fall into the hands of the terrorists and UN moves and they are able to mobilize the world community and the UN to take away, to intervene, just like they're doing now in Syria to take away Syrian chemical weapons and they intervened before in Iraq to take away Iraq's weapons of mass destruction which never existed. If they moved like this toward against Pakistan, then Pakistan would not be able to sustain it or stand it.
Mr. Zaid Hamid, one last question. What do you see in our foreign policy? Do we have strategies for grand alliances to face such threats that we are facing today in the 21st century?
You see, this is the most unfortunate part. I mean, I guess it was Plato who said this, that if 1,000 wise men die, it does not cause that much damage than when an idiot becomes the ruler of a land. And this is unfortunately what is happening with Muslim countries, particularly with Pakistan is a classic example, where the leaders are myopic. Leaders are absolutely confused, disoriented, slaves of the Americans. They have absolutely no idea what the threats to the nations are, and they have no vision absolutely to understand even that what are the philosophical, historical, military dimensions of the threats that we are perceiving today and what should be the responses. This is what bleeds our heart actually. That's why the Muslim lands one after another are falling. Because the leadership was too incompetent to see the threats. Saddam Hussein, Bashar al-Assad, Muammar Gaddafi, they could not see the threat coming to them. They fell one by one but could not unite. And this is what is happening with Pakistan today. We are facing an existential threat. We have no foreign policy. We don't even have a foreign minister to start. And unfortunately, Pakistan is squandering. Pakistan is missing great opportunities of building its strategic alliances with Turkey and Iran. And this is something that unless it is done now, 2014 is going to be an extremely bloody year for Pakistan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Zaid Hamid. Viewers, we discussed about the Pakistan and Iran relations and the need of having a grand alliance of these two Muslim countries to stand together against the threats that they both are facing. Unfortunately, we do not have any planned strategies for such grand alliances in our foreign policy, which is much needed. That's it for tonight. See you all next Sunday. Until then, Allah Hafiz and good night.